I'll usually let people slide on things because I don't know if they know, but that phrase was like so specific that it's hard for me to imagine that they didn't know that they were making some type of anti-Semitic joke there.
I was exactly like the kind of people that scare the shit out of me online now.
Yeah.
So they're a little bit more intense now with like the tanky stuff. But
I was a big, when I was in college, I was a Ron Paul supporter. Unironically. We have spent so much money, so many trillions of dollars. It feels to me like on two things, okay? One is on huge businesses in the form of tax cuts or bailouts, and two is on international wars.
What did you think of that debate?
Well, I mean, it wasn't a debate, right?
Well, whatever you want to call it. What did you think of that content?
I mean, it was disappointing, I guess. Crowder is a coward. I think everybody knows that. Hopefully his fans see him as a coward, but I mean, we didn't actually get any conversation whatsoever, so.
Yeah.
I don't know what reaction. Apparently some streamers found a way to stretch this out for 4 hours, but I don't know what the I'm supposed to say.
I mean, the whole thing is fucking hilarious, but even like, even though this is probably one of my favorite YouTube videos of the last 10 years, because it's just satisfying to watch a bully just crumble.
Mm-hmm.
I was hoping that they would actually engage on the issues, and I was a little disappointed that they didn't. But it's like you said, he's a bully who purposefully targets people that are just totally inequipped to engage in that kind of a format with him. And when he's confronted with someone who knows what they're talking about, mm-hmm. like I felt like I was watching like a fifth grader. Like with the kind of insults that he was throwing at him and the ways that he was trying to duck.
That was, I'm pretty sure, I can never tell with Crowder. I'm pretty sure that was an anti-Semitic dog whistle. I don't know if you caught the BDI thing.
No, I don't know.
He said like, take off your glasses so we can see your velveteen rabbit eyes. That's like a really weird, I think there's like a Nazi thing like Jewish people have evil, dead, beady eyes. It's like a anti-Semitic trope or whatever. That was awesome. So they don't even actually.
We just want to see.
If you take them off, if you have the velveteen rabbit buttons. That's the only thing I'm curious about. It's the only interesting part about
you. Or if there's a soul.
Just take off the glasses.
That was really yes. And normally, and everybody gets mad at me because I'll usually let people slide on things because I don't know if they know. But that phrase was like so specific that it's hard for me to imagine that they didn't know that they were making some type of anti-Semitic joke there. I really think they did. That was really strange. Yeah.
I mean, one thing that I think, and I was telling my chat about this, but one thing I think Sam Cedar's really good at doing is maintaining his composure. So it didn't matter what insult Steven Crowder threw his way. Mm-hmm. Like he's really good at letting people sort of trip over themselves or hang themselves with their own rope.
And kind think, of, yeah. I mean,
I think,
it,
I think that.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead.
I was gonna say it's pretty easy to maintain your composure when you're Sam Cedar and the person sitting across from you is Steven Crowder too, because Crowder is clearly like, compared to Cedar, these are like worlds apart of the types of people they are.
Right.
Like Cedar is like, he's more left than me for sure, but this guy's information foundation is gonna be like orders of magnitude greater than Crowder. Like it's
right.
Yeah, like it's not surprising to me that Crowder immediately went into kind of like damage control insult mode, scream, and then like leave the show immediately, because any actual conversation between the two, like Cedar would have just immediately dwarfed him, like in knowledge. It would have been embarrassing. Cedar probably could handle both sides of that argument better than Crowder could, I would imagine.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, I was trying to I don't think this is going to cause much of a dent in Steven Crowder's view count or sub count or anything like that, but imagine being a Crowder fan and watching that. How could you rationalize that?
I think there are going to be fans at the edge that that are going to think that that was like a really bad showing. I think that's going to happen. People are going to say no because the loudest fans will. Because the loudest fans are, you know, going to say like, oh no, it was bullshit, but there will definitely be people that view it as him being weak or whatever. I know, because when I deal with people like that, they call themselves massive debate bros and then they duck out. The loudest fans will always say like, oh, like Destiny's shit, don't engage, blah, blah, blah. But you'll find like in the downvoted comments, you'll find a lot of people that are like, well, I don't know. I'm a big fan of XYZ. And you know, I feel like the fact that he ducked out here, like looks really bad, blah, blah, blah. Like, I think that's really common. And I think you'll see in Crowder's fan base that rumbling will start at the bottom probably.
I just find it hilarious that there's this there's this expectation of like a set of ethics when dealing with someone like Steven Crowder, who's employed very similar tactics in the past of just crashing political panels and and surprising people with confrontations. Like, why would there be this expect? Like, I think what he said as soon as Sam Cedar showed up was something like, I thought Ethan was a man of honor. But how are you going to use the same exact tactics in your past and then not expect somebody to use them on you in the future? And if I was a fan of some, like if Sam Cedar did something similar to that, I'd be really disappointed. I'd probably stop watching him after that.
If Sam Cedar did something, what, duck?
Yeah, if he ducked a debate, which I don't think he would ever do.
Oh, yeah. And the problem isn't even so much that he, like, the whole setup to this was so incredibly f-ing cringe. Because, like, no offense, but, like, I love Ethan, but the guy doesn't do politics. He runs, like, a meme podcast where he talks to some people that intersect with politics, but he's not, like, a political guy. Like, if you're a big, bad political commentator online and you're known for being a fucking debate lord and shit and you're, like, so brave and everything, why would you reach out to fucking Ethan for a debate on this? Like, what a cowardly fucking thing to do. Like, and he was even saying on his show, like, it's going to be a layup. Like, yeah, of course, because you're a fucking coward. Like,
yeah. Well, hopefully there could be, like, enough internal pressure from Crowder's fans that actually sort of, like, more or less forces him to actually take a debate with Sam Cedar and actually engage on the issues.
I don't know
if that's going to happen.
He can't.
But
he knows that he can't. So he's not. That's never going to happen. Unless they can find the they have to go back to a very niche topic, like, are Hispanic people destroying American culture? Where there isn't, like, a right or wrong, but it's like, this is my opinion on a topic. But when it comes to stuff like the CDC, or like the coronavirus and all that, like, these things are way too, like, can be rooted in factual conversation for Crowder to ever engage with somebody like Sam Cedar. Like, it'll just never happen.
Yeah. What do you think of the HR1 stuff?
What HR1 stuff? That Manchin said he was...
Yeah, I mean, like, obviously this bill is not going to pass, but I mean, like, do you just have any general thoughts on... I mean, was it smart for Democrats to actually even try to go for this or even put it on a vote, put it on the floor for a vote? Like, McConnell would have never done that, like put a vote on the floor if he knew it was going to fail, because doesn't it just highlight the fact that the Democrats don't have enough power to accomplish their legislative
agenda?
Yeah,
this is like a very weird Breonna Joy or like Jimmy Dore. The idea that, like, you put things out there to intentionally fail is, like, really bad. I don't know who thinks that's good political strategy. People can point to your prior failures as reasons why you shouldn't pursue it, like, and it makes you look weak. And yeah, I don't know why. I don't know where that comes from.
The only way that they could, it would make sense if they did a full court press in the media. Just trying to bring attention, because I think this bill is quite popular in public opinion. So the only way with this kind of tactic would make sense is if they, you know, all hands on deck, just really got out there and just hammered it, like, this is what we want to do, this is what they're stopping us from doing, and you know, make your choice wisely in 2022. There's some people that are doing that right now, but I just don't see, I guess I don't see enough of it, or maybe I guess I wish they were more aggressive to justify highlighting a failure like this.
I'd have to look into all the provisions of the HR1 stuff. When anytime people say, like, get rid of money in politics, I get really scared for what that means. Like, you're getting into, like, very big First Amendment territories that make it literally impossible to pass. If I had to guess right now, most of the political capital is probably going towards, is it called the Families Plan? What was the expanded thing that includes the infrastructure thing that Biden is pushing?
Well, those are two separate things as far as I understand it. There's the infrastructure package, and then there's the American Families Plan, and there was some chatter about combining the two and then passing it through reconciliation later on.
Oh, okay, gotcha. I thought that what they called the Families Plan was now like a full $5 trillion thing that also included the, but maybe that was just an article that said hypothetically about merging them or something, but.
Maybe, you might be more up to date on that than I am.
It would be interesting. I think that if you've got political capital to spend, I think stuff like that is probably the more important road to go down, because, like, I think that money in the hands of American people, like, so things like that child tax credit are going to be huge. That's probably one of the most important provisions of anything Biden has done so far. I think that getting stuff like that passed that changes, like, materially, like, Americans' lives down at the fundamental part of American society, like getting more money, I think is going to have the biggest results when 2022 comes around and we do our midterm elections. That'd be my guess.
Yeah, I don't know how long the child tax credit lasts. Is it, does it go for 2 years or 3 years, or is it just 1 year?
It was at least it's 1 year, right?
But at least, but I want to say it was like 3 years. But but it's insane to think that this wouldn't have an impact in 2022, which is why I don't share. I mean, I'm obviously skeptical of the idea that the Democrats can hold the House just because of the districting issues as a result of the census results, and mm-hmm. it's just such an incredible strategic disadvantage for them. And so they definitely have an uphill climb. But the fact that almost every family in this country qualifies for these tax credits, mm-hmm. and when I ask people on Twitter, like, is there anybody that follows me that has kids, you know, how is this going to impact your life? The overwhelming response is that it's going to make a huge difference for like 90% of people.
The cool thing about that child tax credit too is the idea that you can get paid in monthly installments before your taxes. That's huge.
Yeah.
That's so cool. Yeah. It's almost like a mini UBI of like $300 a month or whatever, right? So yeah, I'm hoping that that stuff trickles down and the average American kind of sees how it's impacting their lives. And then maybe that'll impact the midterms, but I guess all we can do is see, right? The America gave, we did so much goddamn stimulus in this country. It's amazing compared to any other country. We might be I don't know if this is true. I saw a graph comparing us to like 9 or 10 other countries. We might be the only OECD country that had like a GDP increase over the like coronavirus season, like coming out of it. Like our middle class saved a fuck ton of money. The increase in unemployment insurance like helped so many lower working class Americans. I think we gave more stimulus than any other country. I think maybe Japan might have did more, but other than that, like every other country, we had more than it was unbelievable. So I'm hoping that like compared to other countries, that Americans are feeling better coming out of this. But I guess we'll see.
Well, just going back to the HR1 thing, mm-hmm. it's kind of it's a little bit of a no-win situation, because if, for example, Schumer decided, you know what, I don't want to put a bill on the floor that's just going to fail, and then sort of send a message to the voters that the Democrats can't get things done. But if he did that, he would have to contend with forces on the left that would be calling him, I don't know, they would say he was cowardly, or they would say he, you know, doesn't really want to get this done. When the reality is that this is an impossible piece of legislation to get passed. And
there's so many legal challenges. And at the end of the day, as much as people want to hear it, I don't really think it does much for American politics. Like it's just, and it's probably going to die. It would die in the Supreme Court on a couple of things that would probably get challenged. I think that there are like some smaller, better provisions, or there are some small, good ideas in it. But the I think that overwhelmingly the stimulus is what should be focused on. Like, get the fucking money out to people. Like, I think at the end of the day, that's the huge thing that Americans are going to notice and that Americans probably want to see.
I think expanding access to like vote by mail and some of the other provisions in the bill would have had a significant effect on elections. Maybe not for every state, because every state's different and some states are a little bit more draconian than the others, but. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of the pieces of that legislation would have been significant. And if the Supreme Court struck it down, wouldn't they just strike down specific provisions and not the entire bill?
I don't know. I don't know how that would work in terms of like specific provisions being struck down or not. This is something that I guess you can read about more later. Obviously, this is just another hot position I have that I don't think is hot, but nobody cares. I don't think that like voter suppression or whatever, I don't think that any of that shit actually matters anywhere near as much as people think it does. When you look at like discouraging people from participating in elections, you look at like long lines, you look at like restriction of number of voting booths or whatever, I think that typically these things don't usually stop very many Americans from voting. If you want to vote in an election, unless there's like a huge prohibitive thing keeping you from doing it, it just doesn't make that much of a difference. And you see that in some of the differences in turnouts for some of the primaries. Like I think Georgia, this recent election, had literally three times a 300% increase in voter turnout versus the last one. It wasn't because of massive changes, and it wasn't that much. And you see that a lot between different types of elections too. It's not like there's a whole bunch of voter oppression that goes on for local elections, and then they open it up for national elections or anything. You know, there was a really good, it was either a 538 or a Slate article, I don't remember, that I read, that has to do with, they go through a bunch of studies looking at like when they enacted this, here's how it affected voter turnout, and all of it was like almost nothing. And I think that the walk away from that article was basically the idea is that like there can be some massively prohibitive things that keep people from voting. Like for instance, if there's going to be like 8 hours of lines at something or whatever, like that will keep people from doing it. But like a 2-hour line or like just closing the places doesn't seem to have that impact. That was something that I was really surprised when I read. The second thing I was really surprised about was the vote by mail thing that didn't actually disproportionately favor Democrats in the ways that the people thought that it did. But apparently, like when people like started to tally up the data on a lot of the vote by mail stuff, like a lot of this stuff isn't supposed to make a big difference in elections going forward between whether or not like it's more blue or more red, which is something that I found surprising as well. I mean, someone in my chat has that. Oh, here's a 538 article on this. I think there was a Slate one as well, but this is like really interesting to read over. I know it's not like popular rhetorically among this crowd of people, but yeah, Chili and Chili. Oh shit, I'm not supposed to talk to your chat. Sorry.
Okay, so yeah, I actually read that back when that article dropped, and I think one of the points that it made is that when you introduce measures to restrict access to voting or make it more difficult, you can prompt a backlash that can electrify the opposition
potentially,
which will accomplish. And I think we did see that in Georgia. I think Georgia is like the perfect example of that. And they did a really good job of mobilizing their ground game in Georgia to capitalize on that, on that anger that voters were feeling at the time. So, but that I think that's kind of besides the point that they shouldn't have to rally like that to overcome an obstacle like the kinds that we find in these restrictive voting measures.
Yeah, I agree, so, but it's just like, I hate to say this.
But that doesn't make it okay, is my point.
Sure, I understand, but I hate to say this, but like, there are a lot of people on the left that legitimately treat poor people as like mentally disabled, where like they pretend that like if you close a voting booth, like then everything is fucked and these people are going to wander around like lemmings and they have no idea like what to do. Like I agree, and I've always said, and I'll continue to say, even though most people won't believe me, that there you need a very, very good reason to put up any roadblock between a person and voting, because you should never do that because it's one of the most important rights I think in the United States to have. But people need to stop pretending that the reason why we have such horrible fucking turnout in our elections in the USA is because of these roadblocks. That's not true, and that's because people don't want to accept responsibility for who winds up in office. The reality is that a lot of Americans just don't give a fuck about politics, local or otherwise. And that's that is the number one biggest reason why people don't vote. Yeah. So like maybe we go through a ton of effort and then like make it like so, oh, you get a free national ID or whatever, and maybe you bump up like 1 point like the number of people that show up at the voting booth, but the main reason is there's just a huge disconnect between people wanting to vote and participating in these elections, period. But a lot of people don't want to admit that. All right, go ahead.
Sure, but I think you can overcome some of that apathy by making voting easier, and there's very little risk to that. If we had data out there that showed that, you know, when we open up these voting systems and we make it easier, that fraud increases substantially, then we could have a conversation about how to mitigate that. But we don't see that happening. So you can get a lot of these people that normally like, you know what, maybe I care about this election, maybe I don't, but I don't want to get on a bus and ride for an hour and then vote, stand in a line for 2 hours and then ride for an hour.
Yeah,
back.
But so like, I understand what you're saying, but that's where I don't agree. I think that the type of person, I think you've got two type of people. We say here, there's two types of people. One person is just like, I don't give a fuck about this election, fuck it. That person, and then you've got another person that's like, I do care about this election, I'm gonna vote. The person that wants to vote, whether it's a 10-minute car ride or an hour bus ride, they're voting. For the other person that doesn't give a fuck, you know, opening up a poll booth down the street, even if it was a 3-minute drive away, it's still gonna be like, fuck it. Because there's a lot of people, I know personally, that are like a 5-minute ride from their nearest polling station, or they don't even know where it is, and they just don't vote. They don't wanna get in the car, they don't wanna stand in line. Even if it's like 30 minutes out of their night, they won't go and do it. Yeah.
Well, I mean, listen, if your point is that the alarmism about voter suppression becomes a little too hyperbolic at times, then I agree with you. But that doesn't, but I still support the spirit of the legislation, and I think it would be important to set that as a long-term goal. But the dilemma is, and this is another topic that I just wanted to get into it with you about, is just the fact that there are inherent limitations to what the Democratic Party, as the majority right now, can accomplish. And it seems like a lot of the rhetoric that we're seeing on social media simply does not acknowledge this fact, that you can't just do whatever you want, that there are going to be roadblocks, and that sometimes the answer is just no. And I think the perfect example of of this was the minimum wage being dropped from the ARP and the sort of response that that provoked. And, you know, by and large, what I saw on social media was the Democrats could do this thing, but they're choosing not to. Instead of I think that a lot of people cannot comprehend that the answer is going to be no sometimes, that you're not going to be able to get everything that you want.
Yeah, because people think you should be able to fight for every single thing that you want all the time or whatever. Yeah. And that's the only reason why, like, honestly, we talk for the voting thing, like, I'd be in favor of one of the things I support is a concept of mandatory voting, that every single person has to vote. I think that would make things look way different in this country.
Would you get rid of fines for low income people, or would you scale the fines?
It would probably just be like paid out in the form of a tax credit or something. But no, I would say that, or you could scale it to income. But I think I feel like in order for the country to work, I think everybody needs to vote. I think that is an important thing. And yeah, even if it means a fucking poor person getting fined, fuck it, I don't care. Like, make it so that everybody is able to vote and everybody has the option to vote, obviously. And then you can draw reasonable exceptions for people that are like hospitalized or something like that. But I think that mandatory voting would be, it would make this country look a lot different in terms of what our politicians talk about.
You'd have to couple that with a couple of other measures as well.
Probably, like you'd need guaranteed access to a polling place. There'd have to be one within Yeah, of course, I agree. Yeah, yes, kind of like how like conservatives talk about, like, you should have an ID to vote or whatever. I'll jump on board the conservative that immediately. You think we should have an ID to vote? Okay, sure. Also, all federal IDs should be given for free. Boom.
Yes.
But they never go that far. It's like, okay, but if you want to make IDs like necessary to vote, okay, sure. But then the federal government should mail every single person like an identification card, or you should be able to go to an office and pick one up. I agree. It would have to be coupled with something, but.
Yeah. So, I mean, what do you, I don't know. It scares me. Like the misconception about political power and the amount of political power that the Democrats have.
It's very,
I want to be in my own way, in my, you know, for my own part, I want to be a counterbalancing force to that. But it just feels like sometimes I'm trying to beat back the ocean. I mean, like, this is what everyone seemingly thinks.
That Democrats have infinite power, that they can pass things infinitely, that, you know... because you're
like the filibuster, getting rid of the filibuster. That's the other thing too. I hear people say, why don't they just get rid of the filibuster? Well, I mean, like, probably like 42 senators at this point, Democratic senators, are in favor of doing that. And we have 8 that aren't, so we can't, and that's it. And people treat it like, well, this is Biden's fault or this is Schumer's fault. And then they talk about political pressure. Okay, well, why don't they just start this pressure campaign?
There's been
so much pressure on Manchin and Sinema, and both of them came out with op-eds. Manchin came out with an op-ed a month ago, and Sinema just came out with an op-ed, I think it was yesterday, saying, look, I'm not going to vote to get rid of the filibuster.
Yeah, so, and if you pressure, have all this all political power... go after 51, 52, 53. Get those extra Senate seats. Like, when people talk about, like, fucking guillotining people, that when we are barely holding on at 50, like, I'm sorry, but however bad you think Manchin is, you're not getting a progressive Dem in fucking West Virginia, okay? It's not gonna happen. You tried it, you fucking failed miserably. Fuck off with that shit. If you want to make it so that Manchin's voice is irrelevant, then you need more Dems in the Senate. That's what we have to do. That's what we have to go after. Yeah.
But they keep telling us to vote blue no matter who, and look what just keeps happening. Like, that's the kind of shit that I run into. I'm like, well, I don't know what to tell you. Like, this is the solution. This is the only solution.
You have to be
to this problem that you have.
Yeah, and you need to be the whitest, most cissexual, heterosexual male in the world to say that, like, oh, well, they wanted us to vote blue. Look what happened. Now we, you know, it's like, if we would, as much as you fucking hated Hillary Clinton, man, that Supreme Court is going to hurt for quite a while. And that's a Trump Supreme Court, not a Hillary Supreme Court, right? Yeah. This idea, I don't know. Yeah, it's really annoying. We need more Democrats in office.
If you boil it down to something a bit more salient, I think, just think of in terms of the COVID response. I mean, does anybody seriously doubt that with competent federal leadership, we could have saved hundreds of thousands of lives? I mean,
and
sure,
our economy and everything else, like, everything would have been so fucking different if we had. Can you imagine? I feel like, oh, even Obama was giving speeches about the fucking about the fucking Ebola stuff. And that was like, what, wasn't it like one person outside of Africa that died? Like, wasn't it like one French nurse or something that flew back? And I felt like even that was treated as like a semi-big deal with Obama giving speeches and stuff. The idea that Trump was up there saying that, like, the coronavirus is done, it's not a big deal, there's only 6 cases when there's probably hundreds of thousands of infected Americans. Like, oh my God, dude, unbelievable. Yeah,
but when you point out the differences in outcomes between the two parties, when one is in power and when the other is in power, you're just accused of being a shill. And I'm not, I don't love the Democratic Party, but they represent vast swaths of America that don't think like me. And so I just recognize this tension within the Democratic Party as just sort of an inevitable byproduct of the sort of democracy that we have in place right now.
Uh-huh.
And I make peace with that. And I just advocate for just supreme pragmatism. And that wasn't me in 20. The other thing too is, I don't know about you, but when I look back on when I was like 20, I was exactly like the kind of people that scare the shit out of me online now.
Yeah.
Same. They're a little bit more intense now with like the tanky stuff. But
I was a big, when I was in college, I was a Ron Paul supporter.
You can give me money and I'll go make the zoo.
Unironically, yeah.
Yeah. So I'm trying to find this balancing act between like having compassion for people that I would have been in the same spot if I was at that age.
Mm-hmm.
And also trying not to sound patronizing and condescending. And then most of the time I just lose my composure.
It feels like this, and this sounds so mean, and I sound like the person that I would have hated listening to when I was 20, to be fair. But like the nice thing about being a kid back then is you were a kid and everybody knew you were a kid. But nowadays, man, social media elevates every voice to this international level. You know, and back then, if you're saying dumb shit about, you know, I'm a libertarian, you know, we need to abolish the Fed. You know, people laughed at you, whatever you do, you go into your phase, like, okay. But now kids, people who are like 21, have these like legitimate platforms online to make it seem like their like train of political thought is incredibly legitimate, because now they could connect with people all over the world and they get all these retweets and likes and everything, and you get like these insane takes that are just so disappointing. Yeah, and there's no counterbalance on that, because that's the kind of shit that like propagates online faster than anything else.
So you think in terms of 2022, the Democrats' best shot is to pass the infrastructure/American Families Plan through reconciliation at the end of the year?
Here's what I want, okay? We have spent so much money, so many trillions of dollars, it feels to me like on two things, okay? One is on huge businesses in the form of tax cuts or bailouts, and two is on international wars, okay? If we could just shit out $4 trillion into like middle and lower class Americans, that would just be so cool. I just want to see what that looks like. And I feel like people will walk away feeling like the administration did more for them when you're getting that type of like payout as well, right? Like I think people, regardless of what the white suburban kids say online, that unemployment insurance has been huge. People feel that. Americans are feeling that. Holy fuck.
My niece was greatly benefited from those benefits. And I have so many friends too, because I reach out and I talk to them. I didn't get those benefits, but when I talk to people that got them, everyone said, yeah, it made a big fucking difference and it got me through this pandemic.
Yeah.
But I think, the big problem I think that a lot of like leftists on Twitter have is that it was means tested. Not everybody didn't get it. I can't get behind that. But yeah, that seems to be like the main critique.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I mean, like if the Democrats could pull this off, and I was kind of hoping that this would be the case starting with the ARP. To me, it represented a potential paradigm shift, or the beginning of a paradigm shift in this country where people no longer cling to this very flawed,
You're gonna say the word
philosophy of
trickle down
individual. Rugged individualism.
Yeah.
And they start to see the benefits of a strong welfare state. And we could get back to a place where we were at in the 30s and 40s and 50s and if they don't pull that off, that'll be a big tragedy for me.
I think
they will get this infrastructure bill passed, because they're talking about doing it through reconciliation. And I think with that one, you're probably going to see a lot more concessions to people like Manchin, just because the ARP had to be passed, and it had to be passed very quickly. Like benefits were set to expire. There was like a ton of pressure.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas this is a much more, it's a much less pressing issue for American voters. And so I think at the end of the day, it will be watered down, but I accept that. I don't like it, but I accept it. And I think it's their best shot. I think if they do that, they do have they do have the strongest chance of maintaining their majority in the House, and they're on offense in 2022 in the Senate. Like they're, you know, if they do well, they could pick up 3-4 seats, which would be huge.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's what I really want to see from this Congress and this administration.
Yeah, I hope so. Yeah. I'm so tired of like a Republican everything up and then a Democrat coming into office and trying to like make do with what's there, right? Like this has happened like twice now at least, where you've had like after Bush the economy was in shambles and Obama comes back, and now with Trump, you know, everything is completely fucked, and now we've got Biden and it's like fuck, like can we start at like ground zero with everything not fucked, and then have like 4 to 8 years of a Democratic president and maybe some seats in Congress to see what we can do?
I mean, it happened with Clinton too. I mean, this goes back even further than that. So Well, anyways, it was good catching up with you.
Yeah, I love you, buddy. Stay safe. Be careful.
Take it easy.
Yeah, have fun. Peace out.
Remember to hit that like and subscribe, and don't forget the notification bell so that my videos show up right in your feed.
If you refuse, I'll haunt your prostate.